Romans chapter 8. While you're getting ready for that, let me just tell you this. My wife, Michelle, and I, we like to watch a lot of reality TV. Okay, we're in church. I'm just going to admit it to you. I love Survivor, Amazing Race, Big Brother. I listen to podcasts on this stuff, for real. I'm a nerd, as you know that, but I am. I watch a lot of Gordon Ramsay shows, Gordon Ramsay cooking. 85% of what I watch is Gordon Ramsay cooking shows. Master Chef, Next Level Chef, whatever chef's in there, I'm good with it, okay? But one of the shows that we've been watching, my wife and I, is The Bachelor. Now, if you watch The Bachelor, it's one dude who has like 16, 18, 25 women, I don't know how many it is, in like 3 weeks, figures out who he wants to marry. They give them roses, they have these competitions, they go on these dates, and in 6 weeks, he figures out who he's in love with. That's ridiculous, right? It's fake. And so when we watch that, when we watch The Bachelor, guess who has to suffer? My wife, Michelle, because I actually want to watch it. I'm just going to tell you all that right now. I do. Now, before you judge me, you're like, Paul, we just had a Man M1 summit. Now we're going to have to take your man card. I'm just telling you, I come from a pastoral, like I'm counseling these people. Like I'm watching it and they're talking and I'm like, that's not real love. They don't know what they're talking about. That's crazy. And then I'm like tearing up a little bit when she's sharing her story of stuff. Like don't ruin it for me. I haven't finished this week's episode, okay? So I don't know what Maria's going to do or Daisy or what's going to happen. Like I don't know all that yet, all right? I'm just telling you. So don't ruin it for me. We're figuring out. She has to suffer through that. Okay, she has to suffer through me talking through it the whole time too. And this morning we're going to talk about suffering. Now I know I'm being a little facetious. Okay, that's not suffering. 2 weeks ago I had the flu or COVID or something, and that was suffering. That was suffering for me. Men, we suffer when we're sick. We run 99.5, and it's the end of the world, right? That's what we do. I was suffering. I thought I was suffering, but listen, in reality, I was just inconvenienced, right? When we talk about suffering, listen, I didn't lose my house in the wildfires that went through Texas. I didn't sit with someone in the hospital and hold their hand while they suffered with cancer. I didn't do that. These little things that I'm talking about, I don't feel like it's real suffering. Those are sufferings. But maybe you came here this morning and you're in the midst of some suffering. Like you're walking through a storm. You're walking through a trial. You're feeling a lot of heaviness. You're feeling a lot of pain. And maybe you came wondering, is there hope? Is there help? Will I make it through this? Here's the answer to all those. Yes. I'll just tell you right now. You can have hope. You can have help. And it's found in Jesus Christ. And so this is what Paul is going to unpack for us for the next few minutes. Where we are in Romans chapter 8. So let's catch up where we are. Paul starts Romans chapter 8 by talking about how there's no condemnation. Now, therefore, there's no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. What is he saying? That Jesus Christ took the punishment of our sin. Like, we deserve that. We deserve sin, like death. We deserve the cross, but Jesus Christ took that for us. And then he says how we're saved. We're not saved. Listen, we're not saved by good works. We're not saved by trying hard enough. We're not saved by checking things off a list. We're saved by putting our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. That's how our life is changed. And Paul says this, because you do that, when you put your faith and trust in Jesus, you are adopted as his sons and daughters. Is that good news or what? Y'all, we can go home after that. We're not going to, but we can. That's the best news you're going to hear, that God wants you in his family. Like he literally chooses you to be in his family. And Jesus Christ stepped out of heaven, put on flesh, and died in your place, and rose again to give you victory over sin and death forever. That's good news. Amen. That's for him. And so Paul says, listen, because of that, we're adopted as sons and daughters. And now we're heirs. Like, we get his stuff. Amen to that? We're co-heirs with Christ. And so that's where, and then he says, listen, now that you're saved, you get the Holy Spirit inside of you. Remember, God said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Now, after Acts chapter 2, Pentecost, the Holy Spirit has come. Now, Paul tells us we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So God is literally residing inside of us. And last week, remember, we talked about how we have this assurance of salvation. The Holy Spirit is like locked in with us. And so we know we're saved, and he's there to help us. And so now Paul says this because it's brilliant. You have to understand the brilliance of Paul, the brilliance of the Holy Spirit as he's writing the scriptures through him. And so now you would think, if I'm saved and if I'm a co-heir and I've got all that, you're like, awesome. So I'm not going to have any suffering in life, right? And Paul's like, hold on a second. Hold on a second. So what he's going to do is he's going to tell us how we can survive suffering, how we can make it. In fact, here's kind of the big question. How does the Apostle Paul help me to suffer well? How does the Apostle Paul help me to suffer well? Here's the deal. Most religions try to deal with suffering, right? One of the biggest virtues in our culture today is finding the easiest route, right? I told you we watched Survivor. Watch Survivor. I'm going to run it for you a little bit this week. There's this dude on Survivor. They have a challenge. He gives up and quits. They have another challenge. He goes on this journey. He gives up and quits. Guess what? His tribe quit on him. They kicked him out. Anyway, sorry, I ruined it for you if you haven't watched the first episode. All right? Right? Like that, like to me, that kind of sums up a lot of our culture. Like, we want this. We want the easy route. We want the easy way out. We don't want any pain. We don't want any suffering. And here's what Paul's going to tell us. There's going to be suffering in this life. That's the bad news. Now, we're going to have good news. But so Paul's saying, how can we suffer well? But listen, it doesn't matter how zen you think you can get or if you can reach nirvana. There's going to be a time where cancer shows up on the MRI. You're going to lose your job out of nowhere. Your spouse may come to you and say they want a divorce. Or the doctor tells you your parent has Alzheimer's. Like, nothing's going to prevent that. It doesn't matter. Like, listen, hear me. It doesn't matter how close you walk with God, there's still going to be suffering. Why? Because Paul went through suffering. If anybody is qualified to talk about suffering, it's the Apostle Paul. Paul was like, he was left for dead. They tried to kill him. They just leave him for dead outside the city. I love what Paul does. Paul's left for dead, gets back up, comes back around, and goes and visits him in the city. Hey, remember me? You tried to kill me. I'm back. Then he's shipwrecked, right? That's why I don't go on cruises. I don't want to die on water. I don't want to throw up. It's all right there. Paul didn't either. He was shipwrecked. He struggled, almost died with that. He's bit by a viper, should have died. God saved him. This man has been through, he's in prison. He's writing these letters from prison. He's in a hole in the wall, in this dirt, where people have to come and feed him and clothe him, and he's relying on all these other people, and he's innocent. Like, this man went through suffering, and so he understands suffering. And even more than that, Jesus understands suffering. Now, we'll talk about that. But Paul understood what he's talking about. So when Paul's writing about suffering, listen, he knows what he's talking about. But here's what he wants us to understand. We're not going to avoid suffering, but we can walk through it because we know this. We're going to find this out, and this is what he's told us. Your suffering has an expiration date. Your suffering has an expiration date. It's going to end. As a believer, it's going to end. But what are these sufferings that Paul's talking about? So let's talk about them. First, maybe you're thinking, well, is it persecution as a Christian? Well, sure, I think that's part of it. That's part of it. But I think these sufferings that Paul's talking about are just basic sufferings we walk through. Is it cancer? Sure. Alzheimer's? Yep. Financial problems? Huh? Relationship struggles? Yep. Watching the Astros lose in last year's playoff? No, but for some of us, it was, okay? Marriage problems, yep. Depression, yes. Bipolar disorder, sure. Problems at work, you bet. A surgery, yep. Just all the sufferings in life. That's what Paul's talking about. How can we make it? How can we suffer well? And he knew this suffering, yet Paul walks closely with God. He walks through suffering. He walks through pain. He walked through struggle, yet he walked closely with God. So how does he do that? And he's going to, I think, help us. Here's the big picture for today. First, we see all creation groans. All creation groans. That's in verse 22. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together with labor pains until now. That groaning, listen, that groaning is not like a upset, mad, angry. It's a groaning for something new. And it's the groaning of Jesus coming back. See, creation is an unwilling participant in our fall. The earth has soaked up our consequences. This groaning is not in pain. It's the groaning for the Savior to return when sin will be no more. But then second, we see this. obviously all of history groans. All of history groans. Like there's this time period of suffering. Verse 18 says this present time. So that's now. There's sufferings that are happening now. Verse 20, for the creation was subjected to futility. That's sometime in the past. So there's sufferings in the past, there's sufferings now. But look, verse 21, creation itself will be set free. There's the future, but that's the end. So in the future, there's going to be an end to suffering. But since the beginning of the fall until Jesus comes back, there's going to be suffering on this earth. So we're not going to escape suffering. Whether you're a believer or an unbeliever, whether you're a new Christian, you've been a Christian for 5 decades, suffering is inevitable. We will suffer. That's the bad news. But here's the good news. It'll end one day. How do you know, Paul? One of my favorite verses that I read in almost every funeral, Revelation 21:4. Here's what it says. He, it's God, will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Amen. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more because the previous things have passed away. Amen. Suffering will end. Jesus Christ ends suffering when he returns. Anybody okay with that? That's cool. Yeah, there you go. That's good stuff, right? That's the hope that we have. But now it's like, well, we've got suffering though right now. How do we suffer well? Here's a key point. There's going to be a point in the future where it won't be like this anymore. There's going to be a point in the future where it's not like this anymore. You can make it through. We're going to make it through. This suffering is temporary, but God's glory is eternal. Your suffering on this earth as a believer will have an expiration date. So why is there suffering? Why do we have suffering? Suffering is the judgment on the world in response to sin. Suffering is the judgment on the world in response to sin. But sometimes as believers, listen, we think we endure suffering because of something we did. That can actually be true. There's consequences for sin, right? I won't go into it, but I think we all understand that, right? So sometimes suffering is because of some decisions we made. But a lot of times, most of the times, the main reason we endure suffering is because there's sin in the world. This is what Paul's trying to tell us as believers in Romans 8. The why answer to suffering is always sin. Okay, so know that from the beginning, right here. We all have a lot of why questions when we walk through suffering. Why is this happening? Why did this happen? Why are we going through this? Here's the answer. And I know it seems trivial. You're like, Paul, you went to seminary and stuff. This is what you came up with. But it's the truth. It's what we're going to see in Scripture. The why to suffering is always sin. It may not be your personal sin. Like, it may not be, like, cancer just happens because we live in a sinful world. It may not be because of something you've done. It's just because we live in a sinful world. That's what Paul's explains this. So don't try to run away from Christianity or God if you go through suffering. It's a part of life. I think Paul had Genesis 3 in mind. Like, this is the very beginning of the Bible. You can go to the very beginning. Genesis is the first book of the Bible. And God created everything. He puts Adam and Eve. He creates them and he puts them in the Garden of Eden, and here's the rules he gives them. Here's all the rules. You ready? I'm going to list them to you. The Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree of garden, but you must not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, for on that day you will eat from it, and you will certainly die. That's it. Stop. Full stop. How many rules is that? One. That's right. We like say, like, God is all this God of all these rules. I got to follow these rules. He had one rule. What'd they do? They broke it. Right? They take and they eat the fruit. And so here's what happens. God begins to curse them. It says, God, verse 14 of Genesis 3, so the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed more than any livestock and more than any wild animal. You will move on your belly and eat dust all the days of your life. I will put hostility between you. Amen. That's why I hate snakes. There's hostility between us. Right? And if I have any weapon, I'm going to win. Okay? Right? I hate them. I hate snakes. It's biblical. I'll put hostility between you and the woman and between your offspring and her offspring. Listen, here's the first evangelism, the good news. He will strike your head. That's the Savior. That's Jesus. And he will strike your heel. Then he said to the woman, I will intensify your labor pains. Sorry, y'all. That stinks right there, right? You will bear children with painful effort. We won't go into that. I just want you to know, I'm sorry. All right? All right? You desire will be for your husband. He will rule over you. Verse 17. And he said to the man, because you listened to your wife and ate from the tree, I'm not going to preach on that. That's a whole nother sermon, all right? Anyway, all right, I'm going to leave that there, all right? You listened to your wife and ate from the tree, which I commanded you. Do not eat from it. The ground, listen, here's where it comes. The ground is cursed because of you. You will eat from it by means of painful labor all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. You will eat bread by the sweat of your brow until you return to the ground, since you were taken from it. For you are dust, and you will return to dust. I think that's the backdrop to what Paul is writing. And that's what he's saying. That's what sin didn't only just affect Adam and Eve. Sin affected all of creation. So why do we have this suffering? It's because sin has entered into the world. Genesis chapter 3. That's where suffering entered. Now, where is it going to end? Revelation. Comes in Genesis. Where does it end? Revelation. That's when Jesus comes back. Amen, y'all. We went through Revelation. I don't have to preach that to you, right? You were here. That was good stuff, okay? But maybe this seems like an overreaction. You're like, man, God is dealing with it. We have this sin in the world. Listen, God is a holy, just, perfect God. He has to be fair. He has to deal with sin. But here's the thing. If we see all this and we know all this from Genesis chapter 3, suffering, now hear me, suffering is not God's fault. Let me say that again. Suffering is not God's fault. So stop blaming God. If anybody, blame yourself. Like, it may be your sin, but look, we're sinners. It's not just Adam and Eve. That's when sin entered the world, but we're all responsible for our own sin. I answer for my own sin. I'm responsible for my own sin to God. And so suffering has entered the world because of sin, not because of God. It's not his fault, never has been. So that's all the bad news. Like, pain is caused by sin, suffering is caused by sin. That's all the bad news. But let's have Paul. We came here today, we got up, got dressed, and this is all you're telling us, right? Hold on a second. There's good news. Okay? So let's walk through the passage. Let's walk through, starting in verse 18, Romans 8. Let's just walk through it and let's just see the good news. Let's see the good news of how we can endure, how we can make it through suffering. Okay? Verse 18, here's what we see. In verse 18, we see suffering is worth it. Suffering is worth it. Verse 18 says this, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that is going to be revealed to us. So one commentator used this illustration. He says, like, Paul's putting out these old school scales, right? Not the ones you step on to give you digital reading. Remember, like, the old school scales with one on each side, right? And he says, here's what Paul's doing. He's saying, you're putting your present sufferings on one side, and he's putting God's glory on the other side. And every time, God's glory is going to far outweigh your suffering. Every single time. God's glory. What is God's glory? It's the summation of all his attributes of who he is. He is greater. He is bigger. He is more powerful than any suffering that you walk through. And you're thinking, but Paul, I'm walking through some tough stuff right now. I hear you. I hear you, and that stinks. But I do know this. No matter what it is, God is greater. No matter what. That's the hope that we can have. This suffering is worth it because we begin to see things from a different perspective, an eternal perspective. I know suffering can sometimes be confusing. It can make you angry. It can leave you in doubt. But when you see suffering in the light of this future glory, it will begin to make more sense in your life, and you'll begin to see the purpose behind it. We have to live with eternity and heaven in mind as believers. The suffering that we endure on earth in comparison to glory and eternity is a short time. It's a short time. When you think about eternity, our suffering here on this earth, honestly, right? It's a short time. And we're going to be, as believers, we're going to be with God in glory for eternity, where there is no pain, there is no death, there are no tears, there is no grief, and he's wiping away those tears. But we got to get there, I know. And you're like, Paul, we got to endure the suffering. You bet. But God's glory is greater than our suffering. Then, secondly, in verse 19, we see we will be revealed fully as sons of God. We will be revealed fully as sons of God. Here's what verse 19 says. For the creation eagerly waits with anticipation for God's sons to be revealed. Basically, Paul's saying this. He's saying one day everyone will know who God's sons and daughters are. Those who are saved. So you go to 1 Thessalonians 4. 1 Thessalonians 4, Jesus is coming back, and he's going to receive us. We're going to be caught up with him, parousia. We're going to be caught up with Jesus in the sky. And that's when we're going to know who the real sons and daughters of God are. That's when we're going to know we're saved. And how are we saved? Listen, you're not saved. He didn't say that we're going to be sons and daughters because we go to church. Just because you go to church doesn't make you a believer. Just because I hang out in my garage doesn't make me a car. Just because your parents go to church, just because your parents were believers, doesn't make you a believer. Just because you're a good person and you check off all these things doesn't make you a believer. What makes you a believer? It is faith in Jesus Christ. That's it. And one day, Jesus is coming back, and we're going to be caught up with him. Praise Jesus. I want to be like, see ya, earth. Like, I'm out. I don't want any of this suffering anymore. I love all of y'all. I'll see y'all up there. Let's go ahead and go. But right now, we have to endure. He's coming back. Like, it's going to be revealed, right? But listen, our suffering will one day be done. But here's what I want you to understand, too. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just telling you the truth of Scripture. As a believer, if you've trusted in Jesus Christ, one day your suffering will end when we get to heaven. But hear me. If you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, your suffering is just beginning. And we don't want you to endure that. We want you to trust Christ, like he's offering you salvation for free today. Then in verse 20, here's what we see. We have hope. We have this assured hope. Verse 20 says, for the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in the hope. We have suffering in this world because we live in a fallen world, but that's not God's original intent. But Adam's sin changed that. Now we live in a world that's slowly decaying. It's one of the curses of sin. So we have suffering. Why is there cancer? Sin. Why is there Parkinson's? Sin. Why do we have broken bones? Sin. Why are there wars? Sin. Why is there famine? Sin. Why is there hurricanes? Sin. Why are there wildfires that destroy homes? Sin. Why do we have Beyond Meat burgers? Sin. Just telling you. Sorry, y'all. I had to throw it in. I love you, my vegan friends, but I'm just saying, all right? Why childbirth pains? Sin. For now we experience this suffering, but we know we will have hope in the end. In Jesus Christ, and the suffering will end. So the answer to all the why questions of suffering is always sin. Even though we suffer, even though creation suffered, we have never been without hope. We know the promises of Scripture that Jesus Christ is coming back. In fact, in verse 21, we see this. Creation will be freed. We see creation will be freed. Verse 21 says that the creation itself will also be set free from the bondage to decay into the glorious freedom of God's children. This universe was made for you, not the other way around. God will redeem his children. He'll give us new bodies, new emotions, new capacities. Then he will make the world new in a suitable way to make us belong there. But these two verses, verse 20 and 21, kind of gives us a picture of what sin does. Sin affected creation, and now it's decaying. However, there will be a day when God will create a new heaven, a new earth, and there'll be restoration. Sin will be eliminated. However, this right here, these two verses are really a picture of what sin does. See, God brings freedom. Sin brings futility and decay. So what does that mean? What does sin do? Real quick, let's camp out for a minute. Sin, what does sin do? Sin brings futility. What is futility? Futility is emptiness. Sin leaves us empty inside. Doesn't it? Now, sin is fun though, right? Right? It is. Sin is fun, but only temporary. Because what happens after that? After the fun of sin, after that settles in, what happens? Guilt, shame, emptiness. That's what sin does to us. But here's the thing. Here's the good news. That's the bad news of what sin does. But what does God do? God brings freedom. And when we're saved, he places the Holy Spirit inside of us, and the Holy Spirit fills us. Sin empties us. The Holy Spirit fills us with all the fruits of the Spirit, with peace and joy, patience, amen to that, goodness, like all of that, grace. It just overflows inside of us. Sin emptiness, the Holy Spirit fills us. But sin also causes decay. What is that? It's wasting away. It's drying up. Sin kills. Sin destroys. Sin destroys lives. Sin destroys marriages. Sin destroys families. Sin destroys careers. Sin destroys futures. That's what sin does. So what's the good news here? It's that in God's salvation, we find restoration. Sin destroys, God rebuilds and restores. Isn't that awesome? Last time I was here, I told you that I had to fix my washer. It was all unbalanced and wobbling, and I'm here. I survived, y'all. I didn't know if I would. I cut the power. I know enough to know that. But I had to get four, I don't know, there's shocks. I don't know what they're called, but these four shocks on there, and I had to install them, and I did it. Can you believe it? I fixed it, and it worked. Hey, I know. Thank you for that, right? You don't know what to do with me. He's watching The Bachelor. He's fixing washing machines. Y'all don't know what to, y'all like, I don't know how to judge him at this point, right? And so, like, I was proud of myself. I fixed this washing machine. I'm not good at all that stuff, and I did it, and I'm, like, patting myself on the back. I want someone to throw a party for me at this point. No one did, but I wish, right? But here's the thing. I did all the work. I bought the parts to fix it. I did all the work, and here's the thing. I didn't throw it out. It was messed up. It was broken. I didn't throw it out. You know what I did? I fixed it. I restored it. This is the picture of what Jesus does. Listen, sin, it destroys us. It breaks us. It leaves us empty. But Jesus Christ did all the work. He's the one that stepped out of heaven and died on the cross in our place. He did all the work. He paid the price for you. He didn't throw you out, friends. He renews you and restores you and gives you a rebirth and a new chance at life. That's what he does. Paul is saying, listen, we walk through suffering and sin messes things up, but we can be restored in Jesus Christ. We find this renewal. We get another chance because of Jesus. Sin will not rule forever. There's going to be a time frame and an end. Verse 22 tells us that present sufferings are only birth pains. Present sufferings are only birth pains. Verse 22 says this, for we know that the whole creation has been groaning together with labor pains until now. God is going somewhere with his suffering. There's going to be a new heaven, a new earth. These birth pains are for something new. There's going to be a new heaven, a new earth. There's going to be a transformation. You see, sin doesn't allow us to reach our full potential. We don't find that until Jesus Christ. Until then, there can be groaning. And then in verse 23, we see our adoptions as sons and daughters. Full benefits in the redemption of our bodies. Verse 23 says, not only that, but we ourselves, we have the Spirit as the first fruits. We also groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. This is an already not yet moment, right? So we're saved and we have the benefits of salvation, but we don't have all of it because we're not in heaven yet. So we have it, but we don't have it. You know what I'm saying? It's kind of confusing. It's got like this already not yet. And so we have this redemption, but we're not going to fully have all of it until we get to heaven, and we wait for that moment, and all the benefits of heaven, everything, new bodies, new heaven, new earth, that's all going to be there. But listen, suffering, we can actually use this time in suffering to make us more like Jesus. Do you know that? As we walk through suffering, this is an opportunity for us to see transformation, to become more like Jesus. The Spirit helps us, guides us, leads us. We have hope because we have the Spirit living inside of us. This is transformation. We're eventually going to have new bodies in heaven because there'll be no more sin and suffering. This is what Christ does to us in redemption, though. He transforms us. The Spirit continues to transform us into the image of Christ. We take on his character more and more and more, even in suffering. And then finally, in verses 24 and 25, we learn about our hope. Even in suffering. Suffering does not and should not affect the hope that you have in God. Look at verse 24 and 25. It says, now in this hope we are saved, but hope that is seen is not hope, because who hopes for what he sees? Now if we have hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with patience. Now that's a lot of words. What does that mean? Paul acknowledges one of the greatest struggles as Christians on this earth is we can't see this glory right now. We got to trust it. We got to trust God's word. We got to trust the work of Christ. This is where faith comes in. What is hope? Hope is that faith in this future that God is going to keep his word. Hope is trust in God's word. Is that God said that Jesus is going to, he's going to prepare a place for us, that we're going to go to heaven, that there's going to be no suffering. That's what hope is. Hope is faith in these things that we can't see right now. And it's tough sometimes. It's just expectancy of the future, that God will keep his promises, that one day we believe suffering will come to an end. We have to patiently wait for his return. And though we suffer, listen, though we suffer, we have hope. And suffering cannot shake our hope. Because though we endure storms, though we walk through trials, we know that God is bigger than any suffering in your life, and he's not changing. He's always going to be more powerful. And sometimes we may not see this hope in the struggle, but we wait with patience. Why do we have patience? Because we know the suffering has an expiration date. So we can make it through these present sufferings. Why? Because we have the Holy Spirit inside of you, and you can have hope in God's glorious power. So let's bring it all back as we wrap it up. How can we suffer well? That's kind of the first question we ask. How can we suffer well? I think we can see from this text, one, we got to do this. We got to let the Holy Spirit transform you during your time of suffering. You got to allow the Holy Spirit to transform you during your time of suffering. Sin brings decay, emptiness, causes suffering. There's going to be suffering in this world because of sin. We can't avoid it. But during suffering, we can grow and become more like Jesus. How do we do that? Here's some suggestions. One, let the Holy Spirit do his work in you. Let the Holy Spirit do his work in you. The Holy Spirit is there during suffering. He's close. He will never leave you or forsake you. He's by your side at all times. He will lead you. He will guide you. He will speak to you. He will help you. This is transformation. Let him speak to you. Let him lead you. Let him give you this comfort. Let him show you how you can become more like Jesus. On the other side of suffering, you should look more like Jesus than you did before. So how's it going for you? Is that true for you right now? Is that true for me? As we walk through suffering, are we becoming more like Jesus? Jesus went through suffering, abandoned by his friends, beaten, crushed, bruised. Like, he went through all that for us. It eventually died, right? He went through suffering. We're identifying. As you walk through suffering, you're identifying with Christ. And we can become more like him. But then we got to see suffering through the eyes of God's glory. Your suffering is not greater than God's glory. God always wins. Your reward in heaven is greater than your suffering here on this earth. But then we got to also increase in hope and patience. Increase in hope and patience. How do we have hope in suffering? One, read God's word. Stay in God's word. Look, as you walk through suffering, Satan's going to want to pull you away. He's going to pull you away from church, pull you away from the word, pull you away from prayer, pull you away from community and other believers. He wants to do that. He wants to isolate you and take you away from everybody. When what does God's word say? Man, get closer to God. Get closer to the word. Get closer to each other. Come to church more. Read your Bible more. Pray more. Like, we need all the help we can get. Find that community. And that's how we have hope. And then we trust his promises. Trust his promises. But then how do we have more patience? That word patience in the original there, it means to persevere, to endure. Don't look for an exit when you're suffering. Look for the purpose. Don't look for an exit. Listen, I know we want to. I get you. I do too. I mean, that's our natural inclination. But instead of looking for an exit in suffering, look for the purpose. What can I learn from this? How can I become more like Jesus? How can I grow? How can the Spirit transform me during this time? You can endure in his power. Pastor Mark Coleman, he loved to hike. And so he instilled his love of hiking to his 5-year-old Peter. And so one day they wanted to go on a hiking trip. And so Mark planned it all out. He wanted to plan an easy hike on the northern part of the Appalachian Trail. And so Mark would lead them around a mountain to a lake in Vermont, and that's where they would spend the night and camp out. And he made thorough preparations for this trip, including coaching his son. Over and over, he told him that it was going to be tough, but it will be okay. You may get tired, but you just have to keep walking. Just keep walking. You had to keep on walking. But here's the thing, unfortunately, the walk was longer and tougher than they expected because Mark led them over the mountain instead of around the mountain. Can you imagine that? It was difficult for an adult. Can you imagine what it was for a five-year-old? And so little Peter was struggling, and he was slipping and falling the whole way. He got to the point where he tripped so much, he cut holes in his jeans. But they kept on walking. They kept on walking. Finally, though, after one too many falls, poor Peter just sits down and he starts to cry. And his dad approached him and begins to talk to him, but Peter cut him off and he says, "I know, Dad. I know. It's okay to cry as long as I keep walking." Listen, I know you may feel like you're climbing this mountain right now, and you're tripping and falling, and there is so much pain, and maybe even this week you have felt tears happen in your life, and you're just sitting down and crying, and here's what God's saying to you: just keep walking. There is hope. There is help. The Holy Spirit, as a believer, He is right here. Friend, don't give up. Don't leave. Don't walk away. Press in harder. Jesus Christ loves you, and He wants what's best for you. And your pain, it hurts Him too, because He went through pain, and He knows what it's like, and His heart is still broken for you. But yet He hasn't left you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. And as you walk through this suffering, you know you have the Holy Spirit right there. You have God's Word right there. You can hear Him speak, and He does not give up on you. He wants to fix you. He wants to redeem you. He wants to transform you. He wants to give you the power. He wants you to feel His love and mercy and care and know that He is right there. And that's the hope that we have, that God is saying, even though you have suffering in His life, listen, there is an expiration date as a believer, that it will be over, that one day we'll get to heaven and we'll be seen in the glory of God. And it far outweighs our suffering on this earth. And our Savior will be there radiating this glory, and we will worship Him forever and ever and ever and ever. And there will be no tears, no grief, no crying, no pain, no death. Why? Because of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. And you and I can have hope today because of Him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, thank You so much for this hope we have in You. You are mighty and powerful. Lovely, perfect, true, gracious, tender, loving. Just, we can't even sit here and describe all that You are. But God, I believe, and I've been praying for those who are suffering this morning. God, we're all suffering with something. But God, I pray if someone has come that does not have hope, that they will find hope in You. They don't have a relationship with You. They walked in this morning. They don't know hope. They're trying to make it on their own. They're tired. They're broken. They're hurting. They're empty. But God, this morning, can they know that they can just put their faith and trust in You? They can tell You that they're a sinner. They believe that You are the Son of God, that You came. Jesus stepped out of heaven, put on human flesh, died in their place on the cross, and rose again. And then they can just ask You to come into their life and be their Lord and Savior. And then at that moment, the Holy Spirit comes in, lives inside of them, and now they have hope. God, if there's someone who's lost this morning, that this morning they will find You. Maybe, God, there's some believers here. They're struggling. They're climbing that mountain. They're in the wilderness. They're in the storm. They're suffering. They're hurting. Maybe they've given up on hope. God, this morning, would You renew their hope? Restore their hope. Give them joy. Give them peace like only You can. God, do a work this morning in our lives, in our hearts. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.